कभी करती हैं मुलाकातें, कभी करती हैं मुलाकातें, कभी यादों में बरसातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें। मन की गहरी झील में कूद जाती हैं कभी, सोच के दरिया के संग संग बहती जाती हैं कभी, चाहे शाम हो या हो रातें, किताबें करती हैं बातें।
हेलो एंड वेलकम टू येट अनदर एपिसोड ऑफ किताबनामा। We're discussing satire today because I have with me two wonderful satirical, can I use that word, writers, so-called humorists. We have Shovon, Chowdhury, whose debut novel, The Competent Authority, has already been making huge waves. Indrajit, Hazra is my former colleague, a journalist. He's written Garden of Earthly Delights and his most recent book, The Bioscope Man. He also writes a regular column, appropriately enough, called The Red Herring, and writes for whoever else will publish him. So let's talk about The Competent Authority.
Sure.
This is, of course, a political satire, allegedly set sometime in the future. How did this book come about?
There were a lot of cover stories about, you know, authors about 11, 12 years ago getting huge advances, which were coming out in magazines, and you know, it seemed like a very good plan to do that. And also the Gujarat riots happened at about the same time, and that sort of triggered out the thought of writing a book. And I figured that if I set it in the immediate future, then I'd have to do less research, because then I could just make up everything, and you know, it would be much quicker that way. So that was 11 years ago, and that's how it started.
Let me ask you this question. Satire, you know, how tough is it?
Well, I think there seems to be a lag that I face half the time, where I write something which I think is funny, but it doesn't come across as funny. But that's sort of one of the occupational hazards, I think. But more seriously, I think satire is one of the things that I think sort of dependent on the reader's knowledge of something out there in real, in sort of the real life, which you sort of riff with when you're writing. I don't really write satirical novels, but there are satirical elements to my books, and I try and use that a lot. And sometimes I think it works. Sometimes you know, the reader probably who doesn't know that something has happened or something I'm referring to just finds it sort of funny.
I think your journalism tends to be a lot more
satirical. Yeah, I mean, one of the things about journalism I've noticed is it tends to be factual, which sort of keeps me more, how will I put it, reined in, which is a good thing and a bad thing. But I think that's why a lot of people, when I, let's say, I'm talking about something like a news item, like a cup panchayat leader saying, you know, if you eat chow mein, you might have, you know, extra urges to do some criminal act. Now, I think if Shobhan or I had written that in a fictional sort of way, it would have been not funny, because somebody's already said it in the real world. So that's something that I sometimes think about when I'm being satirical. And I mean, not so much in novels, but in the newspapers, I think a lot. There's a lot of fun getting misunderstood.
Journalism and fiction, both of you are kind of on the edges of both. Well, you are definitely. How much did you depend on headlines for your book?
Enormously.
Enormously.
The news was my major, most important research source. So completely. And the thing is, like Indy was saying, he's absolutely right. I mean, a lot of things in India are completely satire-proof. Because you can't make up those nephews, you know. You can't make up the chow mein remark. I mean, if you write that stuff, people will say, what on earth is this nonsense he's cooking up, you know. At least try to be actually funny, you know. That would be pretty much the reaction.
And yet, we don't really have a great tradition of satirical writing in India. and tried to count the books. Indy, you're better read than I am, no, for sure.
Speaking as a Bengali person, I think Shukumar Rai was doing it almost 100 years ago. Parashuram. There are many satirists. I think if you read Manto, of course, that we have to read in translation, at least me. A lot of it is very funny and very, I mean, what is Towa Tek Singh at the end of the day, but a satire, you know. So yeah, I think that in English, because, you know, people take themselves very seriously. I think when we write in English, we come from an inherently superior position, because, you know, we know English and 99% of the population doesn't. So when you start with that position that I'm inherently superior, then like mocking yourself or mocking those around you isn't the first thing that, you know, you'll stick to mango orchards and stuff like that.
No, I think that's absolutely true, because I think a lot of English writing in India, I think that's changing, and changing for the good. There was a sort of belief that if I'm writing in English, everything has to be incredibly literary. And by literary, I don't, I'm using literary as a genre, a very constricting genre, where, as he said, like mango groves and stuff like that. I think that's changing. I mean, you're not going to get everything that's out there good, but there's more things happening, and satire, satirical writing is one of them. I mean, there might be different opinions about, let's say, The White Tiger or, you know, translations, for instance. I mean, I've read Hariya Hercules by Manohar Shyam Joshi, which I find incredibly, you know, social satire at its best. So I would actually think that, you know, what Shovon was saying, that I think the problem is that people writing in English tend to want to be considered as more, you know, literary or whatever you call it.
Do we as a nation, do we as a people have a sense of humor?
I think we do.
I think it's constrained by our society, because we're a very feudal society. It's a very Malik Nokar kind of country. And what happens is that the essence of humor in many cases is your, I'm not saying that's the only way to be funny, is to mock people who are bigger than you or more fortunate than you, or in some way like that. But in India, we respect big people so much. You know, I mean, film stars call other film stars sir. You know, cricketers call other cricketers sir. Members of the Australian cricket team do not touch the feet of senior players, right?
I would sort of add a thing to that. I mean, what you're saying is absolutely correct. But I think once they're together in the room again, away from, you know, the Malik, they do crack jokes about the Malik.
But what is the quality of the jokes? If you look at Bollywood films, since you brought up Bollywood, it's very crude, in your face, double innuendo, you know, these kind of really hackneyed, grand, musty type of jokes, you know. I mean,
on television, for instance, I think a lot of things get passed, just mimicry is passed off as sort of comedy or humor. So, but I think that's, I don't know, I mean, you'd know better.
I guess it's evolving, you know, when you're applying this yardstick, it's like Mark Twain was writing funny stuff in America 150 years ago, and he was supported by a publishing industry where there were newspapers and magazines, and there were books rolling out across the country, so it was a business, right? Whereas we've just had like 20, 30 channels for what, 20 years maybe, you know, as opposed to 150 there, so I think it's still evolving. I imagine that, you know, TV in the beginning of TV in America also, it was probably pretty crude, and, you know, I mean, because they're trying to appeal to the widest possible, you know, audience, and trying to be playing it safe, and, you know.
You know, I mean, are satirists already in an endangered species, even though we just have a handful?
It's the public space thing, in terms of politicians are the first off the block to say that, oh, this is not on, simply because they are looking at whether their masters are looking at them doing the right thing or not. So I'm not too sure whether it's just a political class phenomenon. As Shobhan rightly says, it's a sort of master, sort of servant kind of behavior, which is really what goes into play. So it's like, I don't want you to crack a joke about Shobhan, my master, in front of Shobhan, my master.
Yeah, you show your loyalty by beating that guy up.
So I'm going to ask you, how would the competent authority react to a book like this?
I think the competent authority has many weapons at his disposal, because the fundamental governing structure of the country was developed in 1861. The Indian Penal Code is from 1861, and it was put together 4 years after the mutiny, when, you know, the servants got a little uppity and, you know, created a lot of trouble. So it was designed to keep people suppressed. That's why it was framed at the time. They needed a new law because people had got uppity, right? And I think what we've done in our government is we've of course maintained that structure because it's worked very well. We've added to it. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the Section 67A of the IT Act specifies that you can get 2 years jail for annoying people. Mm-hmm. The phrase is causing annoyance specifically in mm-hmm. the law. So if I annoy you through mm-hmm. a tweet, you could get me put away for 2 years. You know, that's how it works.
Do you get flack for your columns?
Lots. But that's actually sort of more about how badly I write, and how much I am sort of I'm in the pay of you know, a certain political party.
Oh, and paid media.
But what works for me is that I get charged from both sides for. And one of the, I think, as you said, one of the sort of protective elements of, I think, the way I write is a lot of things can't be understood, unfortunately or fortunately. So I get away with a lot of murder. But I will tell you this, that I tried to sort of inject a controversial bit in my third book, The Bioscope mm-hmm. Man, by having this sort of small narrative about, you know, essentially freedom fighters, not all of them being actually sort of the sort of holy ghosts that we mm-hmm. talk about, but they were basically, I mean, not me, but my character, see, cop out already, talking about freedom fighters were being young, lumpen class chaps who just saw that, you know, oh, there's fun happening, let's join it. Mm-hmm. Nobody picked it up, and I thought that somebody would get annoyed and sort of say, how dare you call so-and-so this? Mm-hmm. I hope this.
That's the worst, right? When nobody gets annoyed, that's the worst.
Yeah, that's absolutely the worst. But I'm hoping to sort of do more, which will be a little less subtle.
What next? I'm not going to ask you this question. I'm going to ask Indy this question because you're just out with the book, so you're allowed to rest.
Thank you.
Oh, is this how it works? Well, I'm coming out with a non-fiction book on a very satirical city, Calcutta. Mm-hmm. That's coming out, I think, the end of this year. But that's nonfiction, and I think, honestly, I think that it's the city of Calcutta has, for me, become a not only of satire, a subject of satire, but it's become a subject. So when we were actually sort of told about this program, I was thinking in terms of, oh, should I talk about this book as part of the subject also? Then I realized, no, it doesn't really fall under the category of satire. But mm-hmm. And I'm working on another novel, but as you know, I'm working on another novel. So,
that's right. Okay, Shovon, that was a trick question.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you what next?
Well, there's something that's going on, which is that I'm doing something called the Trilokpuri incident on Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. It's I don't know whether it's a book, but it's kind of an ongoing thing. Facebook seemed the appropriate medium because it keeps reminding you. Mm-hmm. You know, by its very nature, and it's something that, you know, people, because I remember, you know, I was talking to some young people, and none of them knew anything about 1984.
So when you say it's a Facebook thing, what does that
mean? It's a series of postings. It's like mm-hmm. a research report. It's a researcher mm-hmm. Who's come back to the country after about 20 years.
Okay.
And he was in an asylum, so he doesn't know what was going on. And he's come back and he's discovered this, and he's investigating it in Trilokpuri. Okay. And he files reports maybe once a week, once every 3-4 days, letting you know how far his investigations have got. Mm-hmm. And what happened to all those people who disappeared? Mm-hmm. You know, because a lot of people seem to have disappeared, and nobody seems to know what happened to them, and nobody seems to know where they went or who facilitated their disappearance. Mm-hmm. You know, so. So that's the story, you know.
So humor has two purposes that you're talking about. One is to just lighten the mood, to lessen the pressure, and the other is to create awareness. Which one works for you, Indy?
I think both. Depends upon what I'm sort of dealing with, really. Mm-hmm. Because for instance, I have this sort of real urge to write a satirical sort of immigrant novel, which I really have been trying to figure out for a long time, and in which, you know, it's not about a guy going from, you know, Mayurviar to Boston and talking in minute detail about missing Mayurviar, but it could be about, you know, some guy from Jangpura moving to Gurgaon, and that's a diasporic novel. Mm-hmm. So that's one fun part, but nonetheless, I find it interesting. And the angry bits are, I mean, I sort of, earlier you mentioned that, you know, the price of lives in India or in our society, there are I mean, I think that sort of encapsulates a lot of things about how society values certain things. And sometimes by pointing a funny finger at something sort of breaks the cliche and makes people look at something in a very, well, it presents it a little more shockingly, that wakes them up a bit. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it works, sometimes people just go back to sleep. But I think, you know, it should be done, because otherwise you become very numb. I think newspapers, for instance, there's a writer in the Bengali paper, Chowdhury Bhattacharya, who writes pure satirical writing, and mm-hmm. these are commentaries, these are political, these are social commentaries, incredibly hilarious.
Mm-hmm. Achha, okay.
And I think, you know, I mean, it just makes a dark thing which everybody sort of doesn't really sort of focus at, like, suddenly be aware of it.
Okay. So I know both of you are a little apprehensive about sounding pompous, but I'm going to allow you one more pompous moment.
Okay.
Well,
sorry.
You're published authors, you're allowed to be pompous.
Sorry.
Any advice to future satirical writers?
I don't know. Don't be scared, because, you know, the thing is, the government isn't as smart as you think it is. The government is not keeping track of as many things as we fear they do, mm-hmm. because it's physically not possible.
Yeah. Indy, last words.
I think, don't be afraid to shock people or upset people, mm-hmm. Because I think a lot of people will say, oh, he's writing this for shock value, mm-hmm. as if that is a really bad thing. It's mm-hmm. not. You just go ahead and do it. You'll get better at it.
Absolutely. We live in times of incredible outrage and anger. We see this anger on social media. We see this anger on the streets. We see this anger in protests, in chat rooms, in real life, in virtual life. I think if we have writers who can make us laugh, who can make us forget, and above all, who can make us think, then we owe them a great big thank you. And thank you very much, Shovon and Indrajit.
Thank you.
Doing a great job, and may you remain safe.
Thank you.
Thank you.
आज मेरे साथ राजस्थानी के वरिष्ठ कवि श्री चंद्र प्रकाश देवल साथ में है मेरे. चंद्र प्रकाश देवल राजस्थानी के उन कवियों में हैं जिन्होंने राजस्थानी कविता को एक नया मुहावरा दिया है. राजस्थानी भाषा और उसके भीतर जो लोक जीवन की पीड़ा है वो कहीं आपकी नज़र से अलग नहीं हटती. उस पर हर वक्त आपका ध्यान केंद्रित रहता है, अपनी भाषा के प्रति, अपनी मिट्टी के प्रति. ये जो जुड़ाव है, इसके प्रति रचनाकार का कौन सा जज्बा होता है जिसको आप महत्वपूर्ण मानते हैं?
देखिए, अगर ये 2013 अगर हम इसके ठीक 100 वर्ष पहले एक सिंहावलोकन करें, अपनी दृष्टि वहाँ ले जाएं, तो हम पाएंगे कि ये वो वर्ष है जब रविंद्रनाथ गीतांजलि लिख रहे हैं. और जब रविंद्रनाथ गीतांजलि लिख रहे थे, तो रविंद्रनाथ के खुद के एक आलेख में लिखा है उन्होंने, जो बंकिम चंद्र पे उन्होंने लिखा है, तो उन्होंने कहा है कि बंकिम चंद्र जो अपनी बोलचाल की बांग्ला में जो लिख रहे हैं, और इवन खुद रविंद्रनाथ को संस्कृत के स्कॉलर्स से बहुत प्रताड़ना सहन करनी पड़ी, तो रविंद्रनाथ कहते हैं, उसमें लिखते हैं, वो कहते हैं कि बंकिम चंद्र की जो भाषा है उसको अंग्रेज़ तो कहते हैं वर्नाकुलर है, और ये लोग कहते हैं कि ये गवाई भाषा है, गांव की भाषा है. तब वो एक आदमी कौन सी भाषा को लेकर करके अपना माध्यम बनाए. रविंद्रनाथ ने ये जब साहस किया, और जब 100 वर्ष पहले जब बंगला में एक मातृभाषा में लिखी हुई एक पुस्तक को जब संसार का सबसे बड़ा साहित्यिक पुरस्कार मिला, तब पूरी जितनी भी वर्नाकुलर भाषाएँ थीं भारतवर्ष में, उन सब वर्नाकुलर भाषाओं में एक नए किस्म के जोश का जज्बा दिखाई देता है, और सारे के सारे लोग अचानक संस्कृत और ये जो परंपरा, जो शास्त्रीय परंपरा से विमुख होकर अपने पेड़ों की, अपनी जड़ों की ओर लौटने लगते हैं. और ये जड़ों की ओर लौटना अपनी वर्नाकुलर जैसी कैसी भी थी, वो हेय थी, व्याकरण सम्मत नहीं थी, ज़्यादा लोग नहीं बोलते थे, या इलीट की सभ्यों की भाषा नहीं थी, ये सब कुछ बावजूद इन सब के, लेकिन उस भाषा में एक रागात्मक संबंध उस व्यक्ति का, जो उस मिट्टी में पैदा हुआ है, उस मिट्टी में से पैदा हुए व्यक्ति का एक रागात्मक संबंध उसकी भाषा से होता है, क्योंकि भाषा भी उस मिट्टी से जुड़ी हुई होती है. तो मैंने जब इन सारी स्थितियों को जब मैं देखता हूँ, तो मुझे एक खास किस्म का एक भीतरी रचनात्मक साहस में उसके सहारे बटोर लेता हूँ कि मुझे भी अपनी भाषा में बात करनी है. तो जैसा आपने कहा, पागी, फिर कावड़, फिर मारग, और मारक के तक आते आते मैंने सोचा कि मुझे एक कविता, एक विषय पर कहना अपर्याप्त लगी। तब मैंने एक काम किया कि संभवतया उस समय मेरा कोई किसी की परंपरा को मैं फॉलो नहीं कर रहा था, किसी की परंपरा जैसी नहीं थी, पर मैंने एक ही विषय केंद्रित विषय को लेकर कर करके जो अपने अलग अलग इम्प्रेशंस हो सकते हैं कविताओं के, वो सब कुछ देने की चेष्टा की। तो उसमें आते आते वो मार्ग आया। उन्हीं दिनों जब आप तो जानते हैं कि हमारे यहाँ आलोचना की क्या स्थिति है, लेकिन फिर भी यदि आलोचना बराबर बराबर साथ देती रहती तो हो सकता है राजस्थानी का विकास और तरह से हुआ होता जो अभी हो रहा है उससे। लेकिन आलोचना की, सक्रिय आलोचना की अनुपस्थिति में सारी जिम्मेदारियां कवि के ऊपर थी, लेखक के ऊपर थी, कि वो ही अपनी किताब का लेखक था, वो ही उसका मूल्यांकन करता था, वो ही उसमें क्या कमियां हैं उसको देखने वाला होता था। तो ये कई बार ऐसा होता है कि आप सामान्यतया जिस रचना के साथ आप एक बार आपकी कलम से निकलती है, आपके साथ एक रागात्मक संबंध हो जाता है, तब आपको उसमें जो भी जो कुछ लिखा हुआ है वो अंतिम अक्षर लगता है और आपको लगता है तो बिल्कुल सही है।
ये आपत्धर्म तो सभी भाषाओं के साथ लगता है, हिंदी जैसी बड़ी भाषा के साथ भी मुझे यही कठिनाई लगती है। मैं जानना चाहूँगा
हिंदी में आलोचनाएं बराबर बराबर है, हाँ, आपको बराबर, लेकिन हमारे यहाँ ऐसा नहीं था, न तो मेरी कोई पीठ थोपने वाला था, न मुझे कोई ये बताने वाला था कि तुम्हारे यहाँ पर ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए।
ये जो तीजो अयन आपका आखिरी संग्रह आया है, इस संग्रह की कविताओं का स्वर थोड़ा मुझे आपकी पिछली कविताओं से भिन्न लगता है।
बिल्कुल ठीक था।
और ये कहीं आपके भीतर यानी आपके अंदर के मनुष्य को तलाशने की या उसको जिसे रीअसेस करने की एक कोशिश भी इसमें दिखाई देती है। इसकी क्या पृष्ठभूमि है, इस कविता तक आप कैसे पहुँचे?
जी नंद जी, ऐसा है कि जैसा मैंने बताया कि ये जो शुरू के मेरे तीन संग्रह काव्य संग्रह उनको देख लें, उसके बाद में बैठे बिठाए मित्रों से, आप जैसे कुछ शुभचिंतक थे, मिजदान देता है, मैं इन अपने इन जगत में इन कविताओं के बारे में लेकर करके जब मैं बातचीत करता रहा तो मुझे एक बात, एक सुर, उसमें बिजदान जी भी थे, मुख्य थे, वो एक निकल के आया कि आदमी क्या करता है कि एक लेखक का अपना एक क्लिशे बन जाता है और उस क्लिशे से वो आज़ाद नहीं हो पाता। और उनका स्पष्ट मंतव्य ये था कि ये जो मैं जो प्रगतिशील विचारधारा से जो मार्क्सवादी दृष्टि से प्रभावित होकर करके जो पागी में वो जो बंद मुट्ठियों वाले तेवर जो आपको लगते हैं, तो उन्होंने कहा कि फिर आप एक संभावना रहती है कि कभी उन्हीं चीज़ों को रिपीट करता चला जाए। इसे उन्होंने कहा कि ये क्लिशे है। क्लिशे का मानी शाब्दिक अर्थ होता है मकड़ी का जाला। मकड़ी क्या करती है कि जाला बनाती रहती और फिर उस बनाने की प्रक्रिया से बोर होकर करके फिर उसे तोड़ डालती। तो जब उन्होंने कहा कि सबसे ज़्यादा ज़रूरी है कि जिस क्लिशे को आपने अपनाया उस क्लिशे से भी आपको आज़ाद होने की तरकीब आनी चाहिए, तब मैंने ये सोचा कि अब इस क्लिशे से निकलने के बाद कविता के क्या विषय। एक नंद जी, मैं आज आपके सामने ये बात स्वीकारोक्ति के रूप में कहना चाहता हूँ कि अपने क्लिशे को आज़ाद करने की एक तड़प तो मुझ में थी ही, फिर एक मेरे मन में, मेरे अवचेतन में ये बार बार ये आया था कि मैं राजस्थानी कविताओं के जो विषय मेरे समकालीन जो भी काम कर रहे थे उनमें जिन विषयों का बार बार रिपीट हो रहे थे, या कि यूँ कहें कि वो विषय इतने कम संख्या में और इतनी ऐसे थे कि लोग उन संख्याओं से उन विषयों से बाहर जाना नहीं चाह रहे थे। प्रकृति है कि हमारे रेत है कि टीले हैं कि रेगिस्तान है कि शोषण है कि ये सब बातें तो तब तक आ चुकी थी। तब मुझे लगा कि मुझे ऐसा कुछ करना चाहिए कि राजस्थानी में नए कुछ ऐसे विषय हों जो कविता के विषय बने। और उन अर्थों में मैंने मौन को एक विषय बनाया, मृत्यु को एक विषय बनाया जिसमें मैंने हिंदी में अवसान लिखा, ठीक इसी तरह मैंने स्मृति को एक विषय बनाया और स्मृति गंधा हिंदी में आई। फिर मैंने स्त्री विमर्श को लेकर कर करके एक बोलो माधवी जो ग्रंथ आया, मेरा किताब आई, वो भी हिंदी में आई। लेकिन उसके बाद मैंने प्रतीक्षा, अब किसी ने ये जब मैं ये काम कर रहा था तब मैं खुद भी इस बात को लेकर के भरोसा नहीं था मुझे कि मैं इस विषय को इस तरह से ले जाऊंगा, लेकिन एक प्रतीक्षा राजस्थान के साथ में एक बड़ा पुराना एक प्रतीक्षा का एक मेल है। और वो मेल ये है कि राजस्थान रेगिस्तान, राजस्थान हमेशा के, राजस्थान के पास एक बहुत लंबी लॉन्गिंग है, एक लंबी प्रतीक्षा है बादल की, बरसात की। तो अगर बरसात तो उसके हाथ में नहीं है, जो चीज़ें आ रही हैं या नहीं आएंगी सबकी प्रतीक्षा करनी है। तब मैंने प्रतीक्षा को ऐसा विषय बना कर कर करके और उस पर उड़ीक पुराण जो रचना की। उसके बाद मैं जब झुराव पर आया तो झुराव की तो एक बहुत ऐतिहासिक घटना थी कि 1600 विक्रम संवत 1643 में एक राजा के एक आदेश के खिलाफ जो वहाँ के कवियों ने एक आहुआ में धरना दिया था और वहाँ लोग बाग मरे थे, तब मुझे लगा था कि ये विषय तो बहुत अच्छा है और धरना और सत्याग्रह जिस गांधी जिस हथियार को लेकर करके भारत को आज़ाद कर सकते हैं उसकी भी 300 साल पहले परंपरा जारी है इस सत्याग्रह की और वो जो मेरे राजस्थान में है और जो मेरे यहाँ के लोगों ने किया, तब मुझे लगा कि मुझे इस पर लिखना चाहिए। और फिर मैंने झुराव, जिसमें कि झुराव का मानी भी यही होता है कि आप उसकी याद में हल्का हल्का रोएं, उसके बाद मुझे लगा कि अब मौन जो है वो भी एक ऐसा विषय होना चाहिए। प्रतीक्षा, मृत्यु, अवसान, उससे पहले जो हम चर्चा कर चुके कि हम पागी और कावड़ में वहाँ तलक वो आते आते वो क्रांति, वो सामाजिक स्थितियाँ, वो सामाजिक विसंगतियाँ, वो राजस्थान का सामंती अवचेतन पर प्रभाव, सारे के सारे लोगों पर सामंती अवचेतन पर इतना ज़बरदस्त प्रभाव रहा है राजस्थान में कि हम और आप कल्पना नहीं कर सकते। और हम लोग, मैं तो ये इस बात को भी बहुत बड़ा ये अमानत मानता हूँ और शुभ मानता हूँ कि हम 66 साल में भी उससे निकल तो गए, क्योंकि इतने लंबे अरसे की गुलामी से हम लोग निकल कर करके आए थे कि वो सब कुछ हमारे अवचेतन में इस तरह से चला गया कि जैसे जो कुछ भी अच्छा है वो इसी व्यवस्था का प्रोडक्ट है, वही है। इसलिए जब आज मैं कह रहा था कि बिजदान देथा ने ये जो काम किया समाज में प्रतिष्ठित कर सके कि नहीं कर सके, लेकिन उनके साहित्य के की जो सामाजिकी थी उसके जो नायक उन्होंने बनाए वो काम तो उनके हाथ में था।